Hi, I'm Joe Feeks, editor of Pig Health Today, and with me is Dr. Clayton Johnson from Carthage Veterinary Services in Carthage, Illinois. How you doing, Clayton?
I'm good. How are you, Joe?
I'm excellent, thank you. Excellent. Yeah. You having a good conference so far?
A very good conference. Layman conference is always one of the highlights of my year. I love the town of St. Paul. It's a great time to catch up with people. The weather is generally very cooperative, so I always look forward to it.
Excellent. Now, I understand you just came from a session about sow mortality. And this has you concerned. What's going on?
Yeah, there's been ongoing sessions throughout both of the last 2 days on sow mortality. And I think that reflects the level of concern in the industry over sow mortality. There's been a very disturbing trend that's gone on since about 2011, where we've had a linear uptick in sow mortality every year. And one of the most challenging parts of it is it seems to be independent of a lot of risk factors. So normally we can sort through some of the different things that might be attributed to sow mortality and select out things that are at least associated with it. And then you can go through the scientific process to understand, okay, do a little controlled research here, try some treatments and see if we can narrow down which of these risk factors is most important. And unfortunately, everybody seems to be impacted in the U.S. None of us consistently find risk factors that we can change management strategies or treatment strategies and have a big impact on the outcome. So it's been a frustrating problem that we don't feel like we have found the real root cause of what's going on, and therefore nobody's really feeling like they can make it better at this point.
Yeah. And I have got a lot of questions to ask you about this, but when you say that you've seen a linear uptick, what sort of percentage increase are you seeing?
I came from Jeremy Pittman's presentation, and Jeremy thinks about this really well. He's always open with his information, and some of the information he referenced with herds he works with is they've went from about 8% in 2011 and really seen that go up to double of where they were at 16% last year. And I think if we look at other systems throughout the U.S., everybody's going to see that similar uptick. Maybe they started at a little higher than 8%, maybe they started at a little lower, but everybody's kind of gone up that same trend line. Maybe not double of where they were, but certainly adding a percent or two every year.
And I find it so surprising because when you think of the pork industry, you tend to think about continuous improvement, whether it be health, nutrition, genetics, housing, whatever. Biosecurity is another one.
Yep.
But why are we seeing this increase in sow mortality?
I think one of the big things is we don't know the root cause of it. So we can define some of the conditions that are associated with it, but they're very vague and ambiguous conditions, which are often multifactorial and have a lot of different components to it. So specifically what I mean by that is it appears that our sudden deads, our unknown deads, our lames and downers all contribute to this. We also see prolapses contributing to it. Now, with prolapses specifically, we don't know the root cause of why we are having an increased incidence in prolapses. And we know it's an increased incidence because that's an easy diagnosis for the farm and for a veterinarian. It's impossible to misdiagnose. So when we look at our records and see that the percentage of prolapses that's occurring is going up, we know that's real. What we don't know is what's driving it. Why is that outcome happening more often? What are the inputs that change in the sow's cycle that's resulting in more prolapses? Lameness and sudden deads are again, complicated. Sudden deads, we are essentially admitting we don't know the root cause. I had a vet school professor that would say, no animal dies suddenly unless there's trauma involved. And what he meant by that is we just don't appreciate that there's a problem before the animal passes away. And I think that's what we realize is that we have more animals that are dying and we don't observe any clinical conditions associated with it. And maybe we even necropsy them, but we don't identify any gross lesions or diagnostic lesions that lead us to, well, here's the organ system that failed or here's the infection that happened. The last piece of that is lameness, and lameness is probably one that is the most complex to get to the bottom of because we don't know if it's a true increase in lameness or if it's an increase of death as a result of lameness, if that makes sense.
Yes.
We don't know if the prevalence of lame sows was any different 5 years ago than it is today. But we do know that the percentage of euthanasias as compared to the total deads is going up. And so how much of that is lameness and how much of that is our producers trying to make continuous progress on animal well-being and making sure that all the new audits that are happening, all of the different assessments that go on, that they're 100% compliance with it.
Are there any common denominators, though, in terms of age or types of facilities or pig flow that you've been able to identify?
Not really. We see, from an age standpoint, perhaps our younger animals may be at higher risk to die than they historically have. Mm-hmm. But in terms of pig flows, you know, genetic pyramids, regions, diets, environmental situations, sow farm types, you know, pen gestation versus crates, all the different variations in our industry, we don't see groups that are overrepresented, unfortunately.
What about flooring? Because you mentioned lameness as being a problem here. It can be a problem on any farm, but you're going to have a higher incidence of injury or lameness, I would think, depending on the floor situation.
Yeah, that's a great call out, and we do see that in specific flooring situations or specific pen designs, specific, let's just call them housing conditions, mm-hmm. you may see more prevalent lameness than in other situations. What I would say is that when we've looked at that and tried to dive into that, those flooring situations or housing situations that naturally have a little more lameness than the others have seen an uptick in mortality. So have all the other ones, unfortunately.
Can you put a cost on this? Because obviously when you get into the breeding herd, you get into some pretty big dollars.
Yep. I think there's a couple of costs. One is the absolute cost of the animal. So you have got the cull value of the animal, the meat cost of the animal that is no longer capable of being sold. You've got an unborn piglet inventory value, mm-hmm. and you could use an average number for that, or you could get specific to, you know, this is where she was at in gestation, and here's an opportunity cost for pigs. And you've also potentially got a genetic value. So if you're a multiplier herd, you inherently need to put a higher value on your animals mm-hmm. for sow mortality. I think some other, let's call them soft costs that we don't always appreciate, are that it's demoralizing for a farm for two reasons. We rarely find solutions for them, at least to date. We have not been able to come in and say, hey, you have an issue and here's how we're gonna fix it. So demoralizing for the farm, anytime you tell someone they have a health problem and you don't know what to do about it, mm-hmm. it's demoralizing to that person. It is also a lot of work for the farm employees. Removing a dead sow is a tremendous amount of work. It's going to result oftentimes in more injuries on the farm to our animal caretakers. Mm-hmm. And it is a biosecurity risk as well. Moving those mortalities, whether you're taking them to compost or to rendering, we know is a biosecurity risk. Mm-hmm. So all of those things contribute to cost. There was a good presentation here at the Layman Conference done by a student. She estimated about $13 per percent sow mortality increase per mated female in the inventory. So if you have a 1,000 sow herd and you go up 1%, you're looking at $13,000 in that 1 year you went up 1%.
So what do we do about it?
Well, there's a National Pork Board Working Group that is actively right now trying to collect more epidemiologic data to look at the risk factors. Collect more data because we have to generate some hypothesis that we can test.
Yeah.
We've done some of that to date, but we haven't been effective. And so classic root cause analysis, we just have to go back to the drawing board on what are all the inputs into our pig production cycle and which of those can contribute to sow mortality. And then we go measure on farms that appear to be over or underrepresented, where we can find them, what are the differences in those inputs? Then we start to tweak those things in farm-specific situations and say, can we affect the outcome? And if that looks good, then you start to put it through the scientific process. Okay, you control everything about it. This animal has all the same conditions as that animal, except for the one risk factor, and we look at the outcomes there.
And is this problem exclusive to the U.S., or is there evidence of it happening in Canada or even overseas?
I see limited data on that, so take my answer with a grain of salt. I don't hear other countries reporting that as a challenge. I think, as an oversimplified answer, the U.S. has some of the best record systems in the world. So in other countries, they may simply not be able to give you an accurate answer of their current estimate. Is it getting better or worse? But when I interact internationally, it's not a concern that comes to the top of the list, or let's say as high in the discussion point as we do have it here domestically.
Well, good luck with your investigation, because it's a costly problem, and sounds like they got some good veterinarians working on it.
Yeah, I hope so, and I can't wait to talk to them.
We've been talking to Dr. Clayton Johnson at Carthage Veterinary Services in Carthage. Thanks again, Clayton. Always a pleasure.
Thanks, Joe.